Well, it's a time of year when tax protesters come out of the woodwork and come up with reasons why they don't have to pay any federal income tax. Usually this relates to we're not on the gold standard, or the Constitution only allows certain types of income to be taxed, but courts have thrown away all of those arguments, and the tax has stood several Supreme Court tests, and the latest one in the mid-50s. It's pretty clear that if the 16th Amendment had come up for ratification today, it wouldn't have been approved, not just because of anti-tax movements, but there were so many clerical and procedural errors dealing with the ratification of the 16th Amendment. It was introduced in 1909 and finally adopted in 1913. The Taft administration Secretary of State pushed it through right before the Wilson administration came in, so there was some hurry to push it through. And it's pretty clear that some of the procedures that were followed at that time would have been thrown out on review, and certainly today in a more litigious society it would have made it. Either there was no recording of the vote, or state requirements or constitutional rules were violated, or the amendment was changed in the state house and so they voted on something different. Sometimes it was just punctuation, other it was really changes in the language. But since I moved to Ohio, one of the most interesting stories that tax protesters used to say that the federal income tax is invalid because the 16th Amendment was never ratified has to do with whether Ohio's vote should count. Now, depending on how many votes and who you believe, either we do or don't need Ohio's vote. But here's what happened. In the 150th anniversary of Ohio's statehood in 1953, it was discovered that Ohio was never formally admitted by the U.S. as a state. Congress had approved the boundaries of the state, but never had a formal admission process, and so the question was Ohio even a state? Therefore, did it count toward the amendment? Was it valid? Moreover, seven presidents up to that date had come from Ohio, and you know the rule that you have to be a U.S. citizen to even be president, and the president at the time, Taft, was an Ohio person. Now, a member of a U.S. territory can be a U.S. president, and so that rule sort of falls by the wayside, and after all, it is Congress who introduces the amendments and approves them, but it was the administration and its Secretary of State that was at risk here. And so what happened in 1953 was Ohio said, uh-oh, we better make sure that we're approved by Congress to be a state. So they had a special meeting in the old capital, which is Chillicothe, approved the admission and sent someone by horseback in 1953 to present the bill to Congress, and then it was approved, and Ohio was a state retroactive then to 1803. A question whether retroactivity can even be applied here. But certainly after so many years and so many dollars collected in the federal income tax, the courts since then have really not addressed the procedural or substantive issues, but just said, hey, it's long enough, we've been acting this way, let's just go with the rule as it is. That may not be a satisfying resolution, but whether Ohio is a state and whether it ratified and whether there were enough votes to adopt the 16th Amendment, all interesting questions that tax protesters tend to jump on. Now, if you file a return making one of those claims, you're immediately subject to a $5,000 fine, and if you do that over a period of years, it's much more than that, and potentially if it's called tax fraud, you may end up in jail over this. But it's maybe the most interesting story on whether the 16th Amendment was ratified, and it's one that I think is interesting to come back and look at every once in a while. So I'm glad we did that today.